So today let's try to power those internals of the induction cooker plate from the previous episode, and those were donated by a viewer, so big thanks again. And in the previous episode I was going through all this circuitry and explaining it, and I also reverse engineered the power section of one of those two power boards. And of course it can run on one phase or two phases, but I connected it to just one phase to be able to plug it into a normal socket, but of course my breaker is not rated for this, so I will not power all the cookers at once, of course. And here are the interference filter, the auxiliary 5V power supply on the board as well, and those main power boards, the fan or blower. And the right board has the small and the big coil, and the left board has the two medium-sized coils and one additional coil which doesn't have any driver for it. It's just connected in parallel with this one if needed for an oval or rectangular pot, probably. I connected it all together, hopefully the right way, and now let's try to power it. And of course this is quite dodgy, but anyway, let's plug it in. And something clicks, something blinks here. The beeping is my multimeter, not this. And does it do something? Nothing's happening. There is some relay clicking and some segment sliding up, but nothing else. It doesn't seem to do much. When I plug it in, the 5V power supply runs and this small relay clicks, connecting mains to this 24V power supply, and it also runs for about half a minute. And then this relay turns off and this 24V power supply is disconnected from the mains voltage and supplies no more voltage. And also the relays powering the half bridges never turn on, so there is no power going to the power circuitry basically. And here is the 24V power supply, which after about half a minute gets disconnected from mains by this relay. This 24V power supply also runs, and it also gets disconnected after some time. So to sum it up, the 5V power supply runs all the time, but the 24V power supplies turn on and after about half a minute they turn off. Well, it finally seems that it's working, but the buttons are rubbish. Those touch buttons are poorly reacting, and this one on the far left is actually the power button, and you actually have to press it quite a lot, but also for longer. And it starts up. It actually works, it lights up, and you can then choose the cooker and set the power from 0 to 9. Of course now it's poorly visible because it's too bright here, but you basically tap it here to select this cooker out of those 4 cookers, and then you turn it and you select the power level from 0 to 9, and it seems to go in half steps, and the dot is actually 1/2, and it's blinking, indicating that there is nothing on the coil. If there is a pot on the coil, it's lit continuously. And of course if there is no pot for longer, it shuts down automatically. It went back to 0. And also after some time of inactivity, the entire thing shuts down and those displays turn off, and then you have to power it. Well, it happened now. Now it shut down and you have to power it again by this button, which of course is hard to press. And of course now it's cooking time. Let's put some pot with water on it, and of course I don't have the original glass or the shields, those mica shields for the coils, other than the additional one. And it's of course a bad idea to put this metal pot directly on the coil, so let's put some tile on it. I have some bathroom tiles, which probably could do the job, and the thickness of it is probably similar to the original glass. So let's put some on it. So let's try it. Let's activate this one and let's give it full power. Those controls are quite annoying. Let's give it 9. And of course it's blinking because there is no pot on it. So let's put the pot on it, hopefully not spilling the water into those mains live connections. And it clicks. And it seems to be this relay redirecting the other half bridge into this one. When the other coil on this board is not used, both half bridges go into just one coil. And those relays can basically redirect the opposite half bridge into the coil. And on this side, it can go both ways. Also, this coil can run on both half bridges. And it seems to be slowly heating up. It's getting quite hot, but the coil is not getting hot, or just warm. And it's buzzing a bit because, of course, it's running on rectified mains with no smoothing to give it almost a unity power factor. And it draws from mains about 5 amps, 5.1, which is about 1200 watts. It's the voltage times the current and the power factor is close to 1. And it's buzzing quite a lot. It sounds scary. And it's starting to boil. Nice! And it's boiling. So let's turn it off. And now the display says H, like hot, probably, because it's still a bit hot. But of course it's not from the coil, it's actually heating mostly from the pot. But with the more conductive aluminium pot, it refuses to run. It seems that it only works with iron pots, not aluminium. Aluminium doesn't work. Iron. Click and it runs. It's actually buzzing in short pulses. It's testing it, but refusing to run continuously. So let's test one more pot. No, this one also doesn't work. It seems to be very particular about the pots. The only one that works is this one. Bloody hell, I have 3 pots but only one works. What if I put it farther from the coil using 2 tiles? Still doesn't work. Or much closer using just a paper, which is a bad idea of course. And it still doesn't work. What if I put an absolutely giant pot on it? Well, this one works. And it also draws more current, about 7.6 amps. And this one draws about 1750 watts. And now of course the blower started spinning because the heat sink is probably getting hot. It's kind of getting just too hot to touch. If one coil draws 7.6 amps, 2 coils running at the same power would draw about 15 amps. Which is just below a 16 amp breaker. But maybe if both coils run at the same time, they run at a lower power. Because then each of them has just one half bridge. Now, you can hear the relay clicking. When I put the pot on it, it actually puts both half bridges into just this one. Now let's try to operate 2 coils simultaneously. Let's also enable the upper left one and of course give it the full beans. It clicks and it actually connects the other half bridge into this coil. Now each coil actually has just one half bridge and it's running. It's drawing a lot of current, about 12 amps. This is about 2760 watts. And of course now it's not clicking because each coil has just one half bridge. Now let's play with this one. And you can hear 2 clicks. One of those clicks is actually the relay connecting this opposite half bridge into this coil. The other clicking relay is actually connecting this auxiliary coil in parallel with this one. Now let's give it the big pot. It draws 8.4 amps, almost 2000 watts. It's quite a scary machine. And it draws 12.5 amps. And now of course let's try the other side of it. Let's give it some tiles. Let's power the small coil. And nothing clicks in this coil because basically it always runs on just one half bridge. No relay can actually connect the other half bridge to it. The position for this relay is omitted on this board. Now let's try the big coil. This one is clicking. This relay is connecting the other half bridge into it, so it runs on both half bridges now. Now the small coil, it draws about 5 amps from a mains. And let's also give it the big pot. Now nothing is clicking because this half bridge is used by the small coil. It cannot be connected to the big one. And now it's drawing 14.6 amps. It's nearly 15 amps and this is nearly 3.5 kilowatts. That's a lot of power and of course the blower is blowing now, but it's still not too hot to touch. And of course both are at 9, the highest setting. And of course those heat sinks have to have some temperature sensor probably to activate the fan or blower. And the small pot is boiling, so let's run just the big one, which now again clicks. And it draws 9.4 amps and 2100 something watts. And as you can see, it can draw over 15 amps per phase. This is really quite a high power appliance. And the other side of it also manages to draw about 15 amps, or about 3.5 kilowatts. So this bloody device can draw over 7 kilowatts at least. When all the coils are running, but of course it can be divided between two phases. And now some oscilloscope measurements. Let's measure the output of the bridge rectifier and it's not smooth. It's a rectified sine wave, 100 Hz pulses. No smoothing for a good power factor. Now the output of one half bridge and you can see the high frequency pulsing modulated by the low frequency mains ripple. It runs on a rectified mains with no smoothing, so you can see this. And let's zoom it, zoom it, zoom it, until we get to the square wave at a high frequency. And you can see that the amplitude of this square wave at a high frequency is going up and down. It's modulated by the ripple of the rectified mains with no smoothing. So I was measuring the output of the bridge rectifier and then the output of one half bridge between the center point and the negative rail. And now let's measure the gate driving signal of one of those IGBT transistors between the gate and its emitter. I'm going to measure the lower one because there is no high frequency high voltage on the emitter of it. So now measuring the gate of this transistor, the lower one in this cooker, and you can see some pulsing. At low power levels, it seems that it runs in pulses. It probably can't regulate the power below certain point. This is the lowest setting, 1. Let's try to increase it to, let's say, 3, 3.5. It's still a slow pulsing, but at a higher duty cycle. Let's try 4. And now it seems to run continuously. And of course the power regulation is quite non-linear, it's more like logarithmic, to cover a much wider range of cooking powers. So when I set it to 4.5, it's probably much lower power than half of 9. Now setting it to 4.5 and the current is 1.3 amps. And at 9, the current is 7.4 amps. When it's at 9, the power is about 5 or 6 times the power when it's at 4.5. And now let's take a look at the waveform and the frequency. Now it's 3.5 and it's still pulsing, so it's not really measurable. Now it's 4. And from this on, it runs continuously, and the frequency is about 77 kHz. And it draws 1.2 amps from mains. 5. And the frequency goes down to 65 kHz. 5.5, 60 kHz. 6, 54 kHz. 6.5, 7, 7.5, 8, 8.5, and 9. And now it's running at just 35 kHz. So the higher the power, the lower the frequency. And you can see that the gate voltage is about 18 or 19 volts. And still about 18 volts at a lower power, 4.5. And the power seems to be frequency modulated, and basically to increase the power, the frequency goes down, which means that it probably approaches the resonant frequency from above. The actual resonant frequency is lower than 35 kHz. And it kind of makes sense to run it above resonance, because when you drive a series resonant circuit above resonance, you have more voltage on the coil and less voltage on the capacitor, or capacitor bank in this case. But it's probably a zero current or zero voltage switching, because the transistors have snubber capacitors with no series resistor. So if the transistors were turning on under a voltage, the capacitor would basically discharge into the transistor with no current limitation. So it probably waits for the capacitor to discharge before the transistor turns on. Basically, the resonance circuit brings the voltage down to zero and then the transistor turns on. It's probably a zero voltage switching. Let's take a look at the half bridge output once more, and let's freeze it, and you can see that it's kind of a square wave, but it goes up and down very slowly. So it's not the transistors bringing the voltage up and down. The voltage is brought up and down by basically the resonant circuit. And then the transistor basically turns on when the voltage on it is already zero. And the previous waveform was 4.5, now it's power 9, and you can see that it's much steeper, it's almost a square wave, but it's probably still a zero voltage switching, and it's steeper because there is much more current in the resonant circuit, so it charges and discharges the snubber capacitors much faster, and it brings the voltage up or down much faster. The higher the power setting, the steeper the rise and fall is. Now let's try to measure the center point of those resonant capacitors, which also double up as a voltage divider for the half bridge. And it's of course a sine wave, or nearly sine wave, but modulated by the mains ripple, so its amplitude changes. Let's freeze it, and it's a 48 kHz sine wave. Now it's power setting 7. And of course at 9, it's a much bigger amplitude. And a lower frequency. It doesn't even fit into the screen now. And at 4.5, it's smaller amplitude and higher frequency. So basically the coil is getting a square wave from those transistors from the half bridge, but it's getting a sine wave from the capacitors. Which means that the voltage on the coil should be a square wave superimposed on a sine wave. The coil is basically the voltage difference between this point and this point. And of course, the higher the current through the circuit, the higher voltage amplitude is on those capacitors. At low power, there is very little voltage on those capacitors, and it's mostly just the voltage of the half bridge going into the coil. But at high power, it's resonating, and the voltage of the capacitors is adding to the voltage of the half bridge. The series resonance boosts the voltage, and so the coil gets more voltage and also more current. And now let's measure the voltage on the coil. The probe is connected to the coil, and now it's power setting 4.5. And of course it's again modulated by mains, so it changes. And when I stop it, you can see it's kind of a square wave with very slow rise and fall, but also the tops of it are kind of rounded by a little bit of a sine wave. And it's nearly 80 kHz. And now it's a higher power, 7.5, and you can see that it's more like a sine wave. It's much more rounded because at a higher power there is much more resonance, boosting the voltage and current. And also the rises and falls are faster, steeper. It's basically a square wave added to a sine wave. And at 9, it looks even more like a sine wave. And now the amplitude occasionally doesn't even fit into the screen. I have to freeze it when the mains is not at its top. So it's basically a resonance sine wave with the square wave from the half bridge superimposed on it, and you can see that the switching happens just before the top of the sine wave. The half bridge switches the polarity just before the sine wave reaches its maximum. And of course the sine wave portion of the waveform is happening on the capacitors, and in capacitors the current is 90 degrees ahead of the voltage. And if the switching happens just before the peak of the voltage, it means that it happens just before the current goes to zero. So it's not exactly a zero current switching, but nearly zero, and the reason for that is that this remaining current helps to charge one of the snubber capacitors and discharge the other, and it makes the voltage on the half bridge transition from one rail to another. Now imagine this transistor in the half bridge is on and this one is off, and the current is going like this through this transistor which is on, and you want to turn this transistor off and this one on. And you could do it at the zero crossing of the current, but it's better to do it a little bit before this, because there is still some remaining current, which, when this transistor turns off, will charge this capacitor, the snubber capacitor, and discharge this one. And it will basically make the voltage on this center point transition from the voltage of the negative rail to the voltage of the positive rail. So you turn this transistor off, and the remaining current charges this capacitor and discharges this one and makes the voltage rise here to the level of the positive rail. So you basically have no voltage on this transistor, or a little bit of current actually going through its antiparallel diode. And now, with virtually no voltage collector to emitter, it turns on, with no switching loss. And also this one was turning off with almost no switching loss because there was just a little bit of current remaining, and this current was actually overtaken by those capacitors. So the transistor wasn't really switching off under a current. So this is how it's switching with virtually no switching losses, and the remaining current actually helps to prepare the voltage on those capacitors so that they don't have to be charged or discharged through the transistors. And of course another reason why it's turning off a bit before the zero crossing is that by this it's actually forcing it to run above its resonance. It's switching a bit earlier to run it at a higher frequency to regulate its power. Everything's happening a bit earlier to run it at a higher frequency than the resonant one, and this is how the power is limited. And on this waveform the slopes are basically when the transistors turn off. And the question is, what's this tiny notch in it? It's probably when the opposite transistor then turns on. Because of course the transistors run with some dead time. This is the gate drive of one transistor, and the other one has to be the same, other than it's actually shifted 180 degrees. And the dead time seems to be about 2, maybe 2.5 microseconds. And the notch is actually happening too late for this. The transistors probably turn on before the notch, and so it seems that the notches actually are the zero crossing of the current, where basically the current stops going through the internal diode of the transistor and starts going through the actual transistor. The current basically changes direction in the transistor. And it's a series resonant circuit running above its resonance, so it's on the inductive side. If it was running below its resonance, it would be on the capacitive side. But then the transistors would have to turn on under the full voltage, and they would operate with high switching losses. And they would also have to dissipate the energy coming from those snubber capacitors. And of course I would also like to see the phase shift between the voltage and the current in the coil, but this requires a two-channel oscilloscope. And of course my two-channel oscilloscope is grounded, and I can't poke it into this live circuitry, which is not isolated from mains. So I have to make a voltage sensing loop and put it on this and also a current sensing transformer and put it on those coil terminals and then I can see both the current and the voltage waveform and its phase shift. But let's leave it for another episode. This one is already getting bloody long. There is really quite a lot of science behind those induction cookers. So this is Diagon Wild and see you in my next videos and thanks to all of my patrons on Patreon. I really appreciate your support. And of course you can also become my patron to support my channel and get early videos. The link to my Patreon is in the description and there is also a link to my Instagram. And in the next episode, a new channel oscilloscope measurement.